Thank you all for coming this evening. This is the first in the series of talks that we have organized in conjunction with Zhangjinhua, The Infinite Nothing, Hong Kong's collaboration, M+'s collaboration with the Arts Development Council to present the Hong Kong exhibition at the 56th Biennale. So this evening's talk will be divided into two sections. The first section will have the exhibition's curators, Dorian Chong and Stella Fong, to talk about the organization of the exhibition from conception to installation. And then the second part of the talk will, we're very pleased to have a special guest, Professor Chen Yuk-Kang, Kurt Chan from the Fine Arts Department at the Chinese University of Hong Kong, in conversation with the artist Zhangjinhua. And they will discuss more about the artist's practice and other issues around the Venice Biennale. 今次個講座系列咧就為咗無盡虛無展覽舉辦嘅。咁我哋呢個展覽係M+同埋藝發局合辦嘅。 咁今晚個講座會分兩部分，第一部分咧就兩位策展人莊道連同埋方永恩就會講講展覽即係舉辦展覽成個過程咧。第二部分我哋就邀請咗好榮幸邀請咗陳玉強教授同埋畫家曾建華，咁佢哋會討論展覽背後啲細節同埋個藝術家啲創作。 創作嘅問題啦，同埋有關威尼斯雙年展啲問題。咁最後咧就會有少少時間係做 Q&A。 So at the end, we'll have a section where there'll be a Q&A from the audience. If you'd like to learn more about the other lectures in the series, there's a booklet at the front. You can also visit the website venicebiennale.hongkong, where you can find more about the exhibition, the artist, as well as visit the intern's blog. Thank you. Without further ado, I'd like to invite Dorian and Stella onto the stage to start the first part. Thank you.
Thank you all for being here. And thank you to Tina Pang, M+'s curator of visual culture. She's too modest to introduce herself, but she's one of the main staff members at M+ with Winnie Lai, who's just sitting here, assistant curator for learning and interpretation, responsible for organizing this series of three talks. And as you already know, or you will find out by reading the brochure, that this is, I think, very thoughtful series of talks that isn't just about reporting what transpired in Venice. Of course, that's what we will do in large part today, but to explore the artist's practice in depth from different perspectives. So I hope that those of you who are here can also come to the other events as well. So what Stella Fong and I are going to do over the next 20 minutes or so is to give you a kind of a walkthrough, an introduction to the exhibition that just opened in Venice the first week of May. And all of us came back just less than 2 weeks ago. So we're just getting over our jet lag. So what I will do is, so here you go. So here's the visual identity of the exhibition titled, the full title is Zhangjinhua, The Infinite Nothing, Hong Kong in Venice. I think many of you already know what the Venice Biennale is, widely considered the most important contemporary art exhibition in the world that began in the late 19th century and has been going continuously. If I'm not mistaken, I think this is the 120th anniversary of the exhibition. So not only in terms of its longevity, Venice Biennale, as a lot of people often say, is the father or mother of all biennales in the world, and now there are By one count, there are more than 200 biennales in the world, including many that take place in our region. So I don't think we're going to spend too much time talking about Venice Biennale, because that's not really the focus of what we're doing here, but I think it's useful to point out a few things in addition to the couple of things that are already said. Each time there is an artistic director appointed, this year is one of the perhaps best known and most active curators in the world working today named Okui Enwezer. He now holds the title of directorship at Haus der Kunst in Munich, Germany, but he's a well-known veteran curator of many biennales in the world, including Gwangju Biennale in Korea, Documenta, another very important exhibition that takes place in Kassel, Germany every 5 years. He did that in 2002, so that's already now 13 years ago. And also he was one of the curators who did another groundbreaking exhibition in Johannesburg in the late 1990s. Again, a very well-known veteran exhibition maker, and he was the one who was the artistic director for the main exhibition of the current Biennale, which is titled All the World's Futures. Reviews are beginning to come out, and you know, Venice Biennale, like many other very prominent international exhibitions, are always the topics or the targets of very vigorous criticism, positive and negative. So I think you can also follow the discourse that is developing very quickly online and in print journals. And we put some figures in this slide to give you a sense of how massive this exhibition is. The main exhibition that I was just speaking about has 136 participants from something like more than 50 countries, but that's only one part, something like a core of a very large galaxy almost at this point that also includes over now almost 79 national participations, plus 44 what's called collateral events, which include exhibitions organized by I guess, political entities that are not nations. So Hong Kong exhibition falls into that category of collateral events, as well as other kinds of thematic or one-person exhibitions organized by nonprofit entities, such as art foundations. If you see this map, which is often distributed, widely distributed in Venice when you go visit there, it shows you, first of all, I'll point out two main venues of Venice Biennale. This is where it all began, called the Giardini, the Italian word for the garden. In the eastern end of the main part of Venice Island, that's where the main pavilion there are two main venues for the core exhibition, and the main pavilion is located here along with almost 30 permanent structures that serve as national pavilions. Over the years, in about last 15 years or so, this area, it's about 15-minute walk or so between Giardini and this area called Arsenale, the old arsenal, what the Italian word for the English word of arsenal, where the ships were, military ships were built, has been turned into a very long and expansive exhibition space as well. And over the last few years, more and more space has been renovated, and other nations that cannot have the permanent structure in the Giardini, because essentially the Giardini has run out of its space. So no more national pavilions can be built. So the Biennale Foundation has been renovating more and more spaces within the Arsenale to accommodate other nations that want to have more or less permanent, semi-permanent presence there. But you can't really read these characters, but you know, these black letters that you see throughout the city of Venice are the venues for other national pavilions. Again, there are now this year 79 national pavilions, and I'm not even sure, I don't think this map even includes almost 50 collateral events. So what you see in summary is not only an exhibition that includes more than 150 artists from 50 countries, but plus 80 plus another 50, 130 or so exhibitions that are happening. So if you have a great hunger for seeing different kinds of contemporary art, Venice is the place for you to go. And just to quickly point out where Venice, Hong Kong exhibition venue is. It's right here at the entrance of the Arsenale. So if you, sort of as half joke, but half seriously, we often tell colleagues from different countries that you meet on the street in Venice, if they ask you where is Hong Kong Pavilion, we say right in front of the Arsenale. You can't miss it. So as one of the exhibition venues outside of these two main venues, I think we can safely say that Hong Kong has the best place, location. So here is the visual identity for the exhibition, a kind of a mysterious black door that seems to be floating on some kind of body of water, is very much inspired by the work that Zhang Qinhua created specifically for this exhibition, his solo exhibition at Venice Biennale. And I guess I would just quickly point out and reiterate what Tina has already said, that this exhibition was co-presented by M+ West Kowloon Cultural District and Arts Development Council. Arts Development Council has been responsible for both contemporary art exhibitions and architecture exhibitions that happen in alternating years, if I'm not mistaken, since 2001. Got that right, okay. So they are the sort of constant in Hong Kong's presence in Venice, and we are extremely privileged to have been asked to present the Hong Kong exhibition second time in a row since 2013. So I think what I will show in the next slide is to give you a more specific sense of what the venue looks like. Here is how it looks. It's a domestic or residential structure. Here's the entrance and here's the wall. And in case you're wondering why it is all tagged up, there is a very stringent regulations about heritage and preservation in Venice. So, well, clearly the taggers don't follow those regulations, but we have to follow the regulations of preserving even these spontaneous expressions by graffiti makers. So they're there, and we decided to use our visual identity and the importance of the title, The Infinite Nothing, as a kind of a floating signage on the wall, and also created this arch to invite viewers in, to almost suck them in off the street and enter into a kind of transformative space that we created. Quickly showing you, this is the floor plan for this quite expansive and complicated exhibition that we created, an exhibition that consists of four independent but linked works, that each of which has its own space. So if you enter here, which is this, then you walk down a long corridor and start a kind of a circular journey from this work to this, to this, and this. And I will have a chance to talk about individual works briefly, but before I do that, perhaps much better than what I'm going to say verbally is the video we will show you over the next 4 minutes or so. So here you go. So I think the video is quite useful because it really gives you a sense of how the space or spaces flow into each other. And I said that the exhibition is in a circular format, so you get a sense, I hope, you got the sense that it starts or it ends where it begins, and sort of invite you to stay and perhaps experience it again if you wish. And I guess I should say something also about the title, The Infinite Nothing, which comes from this quite well-known quote from Nietzsche's The Gay Science, related to a particular section where the philosopher makes that notorious pronouncement of the death of God. And then the full sentence reads, "Are we not straying as through an infinite nothing? Do we not feel the breath of empty space?" So this sort of kind of gives you a sense of the kind of atmosphere or mental state, or I guess I should say almost a synesthetic or full perceptual feeling that you would get in the exhibition. I think the video is also useful because it shows you how it is not just visual experience, but it's also spatial as well as very strong. There is a very strong audio element to it that are integral to the whole work. But what I will do in the next few minutes is to quickly walk through those four works again. Here's all the four works together as a suite is titled The Infinite Nothing, but each one has a specific title, also called The Infinite Nothing, followed by this symbol. So the first work that you see is followed by O Strike Through, and that was the flowing river or stream. And you know, maybe it would take too much time to go into all the detailed explanations, so I would just point out some of the important concepts and motifs here. The artist talks about Heraclitus, is one of the ancient Greek philosopher's idea that's also actually quite well known as almost a saying, that you cannot step into the same river twice because the water changes and also you yourself change. So that the artist talks about as one of his inspirations. When you go into the second space, The Infinite Nothing I, is a single channel video that is projected into this blind archway that was an existing architectural detail or element of this space, which was a kind of a domestic space originally. And then you see this kind of a figure that looks like some sort of a beast, perhaps a horse, emerging in that space. And then you begin to see the artist's signature text projection. Here are some of the motifs and inspirations that are referenced, include a famous episode of Nietzsche's descent into madness. There is a famous story of how Nietzsche witnessed a brutal whipping of a horse in the Italian city of Turin, and that began his mental and nervous breakdown. And this was recently dealt with in a film by Hungarian director Béla Tarr, titled The Turin Horse. So that's one of the sources here, but also the artist talks about Plato, another ancient Greek philosopher's notion of cave allegory, which is one of the fundamental notions about the idea of art and representation, and other ideas that are also drawn from Nietzsche's oeuvre of writing, such as slave morality and chariot allegory. So all of these details, if you're interested in exploring more, we cover it quite extensively in our catalog, so that's available. And then you follow that narrow passageway that was specifically constructed for this exhibition to emerge in this third space with The Infinite Nothing I Strike Through. What you see here are two windows that are also existing architectural elements, but these are actual windows that can be opened out into the exterior, but the artist has decided to turn them into projection screens where he projects what might be a kind of a landscape that you would see through the window, in this case specifically a stormy sky outside with raindrops rolling down on the glass. And what you perhaps couldn't see so clearly in the video and also in this image is that there is kind of simulated leakage that happens in the space. So some mysterious liquid drips and puddles in the space as well. So it gives you a sense of representation and reality, both things existing on at least two different kinds of ways. And you turn to your right and come to the final, fourth and final space. Maybe most people in this audience are most familiar with this kind of work that the artist has done, but done in a very ambitious scale, projected on three sides, and also incorporating this opening and the wall that stands behind. A lot of the texts are again drawn from other sources, such as the Bible and Nietzsche's writing. But in general, the artist speaks a lot about not just these Western religious and philosophical sources, but Eastern ideas that are derived from Taoism and Buddhism as a very important aspect of his inspiration. So this is a quick walkthrough of the exhibition and the four works that constituted, but exhibition making, of course, isn't just all about conceptualization, explanation. It's all also about specific logistics. You know, how do you build the space? How do you fill the space? So that very difficult part, I'm gonna hand it over to my co-curator Stella Fang to explain.
Thank you. So, before Tang Hiwa come up with the exhibition proposal, actually he did a site visit in August, and then when he returned to Hong Kong, and then he actually has a draft proposal. And then in December, so we actually made a trip to Venice again to discuss with the contractors and also the architects to see the feasibility of his plan, and then to fine tune all the details, and also to see how visitors can experience the whole exhibitions on site. So so you can see from the slide, so we have site visits, and also we also met the contractors in Venice, and also we did a lot of different meetings with designers. Just for your information, actually for the realization of the whole exhibition, so we have a big team, apart from the co-curators, we also have VB assistant curator Sharon, who is also here today, and we also collaborated with the Italian agent, who is also kind of a coordinator, between the biennial office, the landlord, as long as we come up with some ideas, and they try to talk to the different parties there, and also we also have an architect. Because he's very important, especially because he also need to seek permission in Venice, and also especially for the temporary structure there, and he also help us to line up with different contractors. And in terms of, you can see from Dorian's presentation, the whole exhibition is so complex. So at the end, we also have different contractors from building the structure, and also to electricians and also AV technicians who will also help up for the setup of the exhibition. And of course, we also have designers from Hong Kong as well as, we also fly AV technicians from Hong Kong to Venice as well to help out for the installation. So to refresh your memory, so this is the exhibition we did in 2013 for Leakage Exhibition. So you can see there's a courtyard, and also there are some exhibition spaces within the site. But this time, you can tell that especially the Hong Kong Pavilion, if you're familiar with that site, actually we have a big courtyard in front of the galleries. So this time we tried to cover the entire courtyard to turn the interior outdoor space into an indoor space. Especially the artists really want to turn daytime into nighttime. So at the end, this is a huge task for us before he makes his exhibition, because you can tell. So this is, so this is the courtyard. So there are, I mean, some challenges we came across, I mean, during the whole preparation period. For instance, as Dorian also mentioned, because these are all historical buildings, so we cannot touch all the walls, all the facade of the building. So we have to build a standalone structure in order to you know, create another independent space outside the gallery space. And also because we need to build a structure which is also waterproof, but on the other hand, we also need to allow rain comes into the structure for drainage purpose. So actually we need to leave some gap, you know, in between. So maybe you can't see very clearly. Actually we leave some gap in between the space so that we can allow the rains to come in. And then since we have some gaps, but we need a completely dark space in order to realize the projection on the floor. So we need a completely dark space. So at the end, we also need to seal, you know, all these gaps, you know, to make it like a completely dark space for the exhibition. And of course, because for instance, in total, actually we used up to like 20 projectors. I mean, even though for the outdoor space in this area for the river, the one that you just saw, I mean, from the video, so we have already used like 10 projectors. So we need to make sure the structure is, especially the loading is strong enough, you know, to hold, you know, 10 projectors as well as the speakers. And on the other hand, because we completely seal the whole exhibition space, so we need to allow air circulation inside and then make sure there are ventilation, and also we need to reduce the heat on the rooftop, especially because there's so many projectors, so we need to make sure all these kind of things. And of course, I mean, the most difficult part at the end, we realize, is because we need to seek the temporary license from the city council, which is so complicated, it takes a long time. And then we also need to get consent from all the neighbors, you know, near the building. But of course, I mean, at the end, you know, we try, you know, very hard, you know, to solve this problem. So that's the reason why actually we've spent quite a long time, you know, to deal with the whole thing. And of course, we actually made quite a number of changes, I mean, during the whole, you know, period. I mean, even the last minute, you know, before we confirm, you know, the contract, we also need to make some adjustment just to make sure that, you know, this is feasible and then, you know, we can do it and then the contractors, you know, feel like this is a safe structure. So you can also see, you know, but I mean, amazingly, I mean, at the end, we spent like 10 days to finish the whole construction work. For us, I mean, we're kind of like, because we heard from people saying that, well, in Italy, in Venice, you know, the technicians, they're pretty slow and laid back. But at the end, we're so lucky this time because we have an amazing team. And then they really finished the whole thing within 10 days. So you can see from the outdoor structure, to we also built the corridors. And then you can see there is a little short tunnel from the river to the Plato's cave. And then, so after we finished the construction, so we started to do the installation, like the projectors. As I just mentioned, we also fly three AV technicians from Hong Kong to do the installation. And also we also build a specific system for the whole thing. And then they also help up to do the edge blending of the videos. And one thing which is also good to mention, because of the building itself, these beams, just because this is historical buildings over like, I don't know, 100 or 20, 200 years. So we cannot touch the ceiling. We can only, you know, use the beams, but the beams, they have limited capacity, you know, to hold those projectors. So we also, you know, have a lot of discussions to see how, you know, we can mount these projectors on the ceiling. And so you can also tell that, well, I mean, if you get a chance to look at this show, actually you didn't realize there's so many cables, you know, running around the whole, you know, exhibition. And it's also good to mention that we also have two technical interns flying to Venice to help us, you know, to do the installation and throughout the whole period. So you can see, you know, there are lots of edge blending work and also cabling work. So the internship program was led by Tina, our curator, and also Winnie as well. So in total, we recruited 2 technical interns and 10 exhibition interns. And also just for this Venice project, we also recruited 1 18-month-long curatorial intern specifically working for this and also supporting this project. And so, I mean, the first batch, they're so lucky because, you know, they can, you know, travel with us, you know, during the whole installation period. So you can see, you know, they are helping out for the whole exhibition period. But before that, actually, Tina and the team also arranged various kind of meetings. So you can see the interns, they get a chance to meet with the curators, the artists, and then to have a brief understanding of what is, you know, Venice Biennale is history, and also what is the Hong Kong participation before. And then they also get a chance to visit Zheng Yiwa's studio in Voten, and then to have a better understanding of the artistic practice, and also to get a glimpse of the work before it's properly, you know, in store in Venice. And then they also did a blog writing session to learn about, because they actually need to contribute, you know, some blogs, you know, during their stay in Venice. So if you search in, you know, Hong Kong Venice, the interns blog, you find a lot of interesting stories from like survival kit, you know, 15 things, you know, that they learn in living in Venice, to, you know, if you're really missing, you know, Chinese food, how can you make udon, you know, in Venice. So they have a lot of, you know, very interesting stories, you know, during their stay. And for the 10 exhibition interns, actually they will fly to Venice in 5 different groups. So each one of them will stay there for 6 weeks. So they will perform, an exhibition attendant. They will look after the show and then, you know, do the operation, like, you know, daily operation of the exhibitions. And we have the opening reception on the 7th of May. And I mean, over the few days of the preview period, we received over 5,500 visitors in total. And also we led a lot of different tours, and also from media and also to special groups during this period. And then we also host opening dinner in a venue nearby. I think the purpose of the dinner actually is to invite key players from the art circle, namely art critics, journalists, museum directors, collectors, artists, you know, from all over the world, you know, to come and then to know more about the artist's work, to understand more about M+, and also the exhibition. And of course, I mean, this is also a great chance, you know, for us to make connections with different professions, professional in the field. And then so far, I mean, even though we haven't yet, you know, opened the exhibition for more than a month, but we received a lot of different media coverage from local to international journals, specifically like Berlin Art. You know, they have chosen Zheng Yiwa's exhibition as the top 6 most memorable installations that you must see in the Venice Biennale. So I think, and also you can also tell, you know, from art review to art newspaper, and then these are really, really good, you know, reviews for the exhibitions. And of course, I mean, apart from the shows, we also produce brochures, exhibition catalogs, and the website we just mentioned. I mean, as long as you click to the website, you can see a lot of information about the show and also the documentations. So we really hope, you know, these channels can help to publicize the whole event and then to make more people to understand, you know, about, you know, the content and also the artists and also us. So my presentation is...
So maybe... In closing this part of the discussion, and before we invite Zheng Yiwa and Professor Chan to come up here, I guess maybe I would just share a couple of observations. During the time that we were there, 3 days of preview followed by public opening, you know, this is the time that you can meet a lot of colleagues from all over the place. And one of the things that was said to me repeatedly is that, wow, this is such a high-tech exhibition, which just sort of kind of stopped me in the track, and I thought about it. And then after a while, I had an answer to that kind of a statement about the exhibition. And my feeling was that for me, Zhang Qinwai is not a high-tech artist. You know, his main medium may be digital animation, but to me, he's a very old-fashioned, old-school artist. And maybe, you know, he can totally contradict me when it comes up here, but since he's not here yet, I will just say it anyway. That, you know, for me, here's an artist who sits in his studio alone without an army of assistants and puts together these videos almost brushstroke by brushstroke, except that it's in digital form. But once he has created this suite of works, there needed to be, we play a certain role as curators, but as Acela also mentioned, there were very able technicians that we were able to find in Hong Kong and who were so dedicated and spent almost more than a month with us in Venice to translate these paintings, if you will, that he creates in his studio in Photon into an all-enveloping, all-encompassing, and perceptually transformative experiences. And there is a lot of technical knowledge, know-how, and translation needed to go in. But ultimately, when it ends, then we needed to have all the cabling, all the edge blending, all the alignment disappear so that you only think about the art and you don't think about all the preparations, include from construction all the way to the most digital part of it into the background so that you don't think about it. And I guess I can proudly report that we were able to accomplish that. And the responses, not just in media, but how responses that you get from the public members, but also from your professional colleagues, were overwhelmingly positive and appreciative. So I'm also very happy that we can report that. And just to give you a sense of how much of an exposure, whether you like it or not, that you get in Venice is borne out by the numbers of the visitors that you get. So just during the 3-day preview period for the press and professionals, I think we had about 5,500 people coming into the exhibition. And during the first week, just on the opening day, you know, I mean, our opening day was a sort of public opening, but we had already been open for, I think, 2 days or something. But on the official opening day, we had more than 2,000 visitors. And in the course of about 2 weeks from the preview to the first 2 weeks of the exhibition, we had close to 20,000 visitors. So this is really important, not only for the artist, but for Hong Kong representation in Venice. But those are just figures. So now I think we should invite the artist and his conversation partner.
Are we going to change the channel in Cantonese? So, okay.我想問同阿張建華嘅關係啦，其實就係應該係喺中文大學嘅時候咧，我教書嘅時候咧，佢啱啱咧就係個係學生啦。咁我喺五十一屆嘅威尼斯雙年展嘅時候，我都有參加，但係嗰陣時就可能係冇阿華，我哋嗰陣時叫做華哥哥嘅啊，冇阿華哥哥咁好運，就有咁好嘅 team 咧嚟到back up咁多嘢啦。咁我今日聽完阿 Dorian 介紹嘅作品嘅時候，首先我恭喜阿華啦，因為我覺得個展覽咧，即使咧我冇現場去睇咧。 我淨係喺呢度聽阿 Dorian 同埋阿 Stella 介紹嘅時候，我都覺得都幾相當之 touching。其實呢個今次亦都唔係我第一次睇呢個 video，今次應該係第三次睇，我屋企睇咗一次，去佢哋 office 睇一次，然後今日又睇一次。今日咧就可能係最 touching 嘅一次，因為個 screen 比較大啲，同埋 Dorian 講得非常好啊。 即係我能夠將我帶入去嗰個展覽現場，其實我同大家一樣啦，或者在座大部分嘅觀眾一樣咧，都我都冇去過現場。咁當然裏邊有好多好複雜嘅內容，特別係關於尼采啦嚇，關於尼采嘅好多嘅唔同嘅片段嘅一啲嘅諗法，但係當然係經過。 阿華嘅一個interpretation，但我第一樣感受到一樣嘢就係嗰個 space 嗰個嘅節奏，即係個節奏同埋嗰個空間同埋建造新建造嘅空間同埋舊建造舊時已經存在空間之間嘅一個嘅對比。當中我諗真係我覺得今次你嘅 curatorial team 真係好愛你，因為如果唔係咧，真係好難咁。 投入去到俾到咁多資源嚟到，同埋嗰個資源都仲係其次。大家好想參與幫你完成你嘅作品呢樣嘢，我覺得非常之令人感動，因為往往喺一個咁大嘅展覽場合咧，其實我哋成日睇到嘅嘢好多時都係。 以為係一個淨係一個 artist 嘅一個個人嘅作品，即係睇到 artist 個名，但係就好少留意後邊嗰個 team 所能幫手所做到嘅嘢。咁當然中間嗰個 curatorial team 做到咩地步，同埋 artist 嘅原意之間會唔會有一個落差，或者係嗰個 team 其實幫個 artist 更加 further 去到 develop 佢嗰個嘅睇法咧？呢樣嘢我諗就～ 我都想問一問啊，即係話咁多人參與呢個 project， 喺你諗呢個 project 嘅時候，同埋當你真係見到個 project 被 realise 嘅時候，你大家都呢個 team 咧嗰個嘅角色咧，其實係幫咗你啲乜，又或者咧其實阻止咗你一啲乜嘢？即係如果有嘢阻止，譬如好似我明明想咧咁嘅。 嗰度光嘅，不過佢話唔得喎，因為咧個 architectural space 令到你一定要喺嗰度光喎，咁會唔會有呢啲咁嘅情況出現，令到你係即係話有種叫做一趁而家咧，就好多觀眾喺度有咩苦咧，都可以咧喺呢度可以講少少。<笑><笑>其實冇乜苦嘅，咁。
其實阿 Stella 不嬲都同我講話，我好幸運，嗰時冇我，其實我真係幾幸運嘅。咁因為我知道成個展覽其實佢哋每一位其實都滿滿足到好嘢。咁我亦都雖然我唔需要跟足所有嘢，但係有陣時我跟某啲嘢，其實我都覺得好煩嘅。咁所以其實我好多謝佢哋幫我手處理所有即係展覽嘅嘢嘅。咁同埋又。 再加上catalog嗰啲又要處理好多文章，寫好多嘢，佢哋其實之前未接觸，有幾位未接觸過我諗嘅嘢嘅，咁所以就佢哋會比較辛苦少少，所以都好多謝曬。
佢一直頭幫你，佢哋幫你手做嗰啲唔想做或者唔願意做嘅嘢，你當然要多謝佢啦。但我想問咧，就係話其實咧，佢哋有冇因為牽涉到 technical 嘅問題，會唔會佢哋有啲係佢哋嘅諗法咧嚟 override 你嘅諗法㗎？會唔會咁？
有啲咁嘅情況？有冇嘅？就係純粹我可能其實咗個問題，其實未必喺佢哋度咯。譬如話，我當初未開始正式諗呢個 project 時候，或者未正式諗只係 cover 一個地方嘅時候，其實諗到好誇張嘅，即係可能係成幾層、成棟嘢 cover 曬，甚至乎係跟住後屘修正咗咁嘅 cover， 不如淨係純粹成個 core 打橫 cover 曬佢啦，咁好似幾好啲喎。咁但係因為好多後屘就即係好多嘅技術問題，有好多規條限，咁但係佢哋都幫我處理咗好多嘅問題嘅，所以佢哋其實冇乜阻撓。我想問，因為我知道你開始嘅時候咧，入去呢個
site 嘅時候咧，因為個展覽開始被。 建築或者俾嗰個 idea 俾實踐之前咧，其實你有 site visit 嘅嘛，你第一個印象對於呢個空間見到嘅時候咧，有啲咩嘅感覺？
我其實未正式去之前，其實我都睇過相嘅，所以我都知道個大約個效果係點，即係個情況點樣嘅。咁我嗰個感覺係覺得好都幾難搞嘅空間，因為佢分開咗幾橛細嘅空間，然後再出邊有一個大嘅 courtyard， 而嗰個 courtyard 係相當之光猛，嗰種光猛又係我好唔想要嘅光猛咯。咁所以喺點樣用個空間其實都幾大嘅問題咯，初初即係幾大嘅一個問題啦。
你係淨係諗下自己諗自己嘅作品點樣被表現啦，定係話其實嗰個空間咧，其實俾咗一啲特別嘅 hints 或者係俾到一啲刺激你，令到你咧係可以將你原本嘅意念咧係可以再調節一下咁嘅。即係話，我咁聽就好似話，你好似將個空間諗成，我要做一啲作品，然後咧就最好有個中性空間，又或者有啲一啲技術人員幫你搭好曬所有嘅嘢，咁然咧你就可以完全唔使理嗰個現存嗰個空間嘅一個，譬如我叫佢做物理上邊嘅特性，歷史上邊嘅一啲嘅特性嗰啲。你其實有冇考慮翻？其實你喺嗰度做嗰啲嘢嘅時候，其實同個原本嗰個 site 嘅關係咧，點樣被建立嘅？
其實我不嬲都好中意，即係就住唔同地方嘅特色去做嗰啲作品嘅。而今次亦都係嘅，只不過頭先難搞係覺得現有嘅空間點樣去運用得好係相當困難咯，因為佢斬開幾橛，咁但係我又唔想每橛細嘅空間擠唔同嘅作品，而大家又冇一個關聯，好似係咁，我覺得會比較散，所以我就想將佢統一咗做一嚿嘢。咁啱亦都係因為呢個展覽分開做幾個空間，咁所以先至令到我可以形成到一個 journey， 即係一個旅程，可以喺入邊度做到咯。
如果
係。係冇錯冇錯。基本上我係睇咗個細節，然後先至有啲嘢會令到我想去做嘅。譬如頭先講個窗口嗰樣嘢，其實我係見到個窗口，覺得好似有啲特別，同埋加咗個拱門，亦都係一個佢本身亦都有特別性喺度。咁兩邊亦都細拱門，咁所以嗰樣嘢我覺得係都幾有特別意思。咁就因住呢啲咁嘅本身現有的一啲嘅空間嘅特色嘅嘢，咁然後去做一啲嘅作品去 fit 翻入去咁咯。
因為今次我睇完之後有一個好強嘅感覺，就係因為我都有睇過阿華以前嘅一啲嘅作品。我覺得今次佢因為可能人力啊、物力啊，或者係你喺度思考完作品嗰個時間比較長，我覺得係已經開始變成有少少成個一個好似一個幾宏大的敘事方法的一種的做法，簡單來說就是一個我們叫做史詩的一種有很宏大，也都是能夠跟我們那個哲學上面的傳統以至到歷史產生一些關係。這件事其實你覺得有些跟你以前那些片段式的做法有些不同的，你可不可以講一點其實那個分別在哪裡？
分別一來個空間問題，今次容許到，因為以前我的展覽通常都係可能只係一個空間展一件，最多兩件作品，或者空間比較簡單啲，都係一個大嘅盒，或者係一條樓梯、一個廁所咁樣。咁所以嗰個空間其實比較細同埋比較單一嘅。今次做得多少少，因為嗰個空間本身有容許到我咁樣做法。再加上我又去到某個時間咁上下，我又覺得嗰段時間我係睇緊啲書，咁亦都開始整理翻自己諗緊嘅嘢。咁所以睇到咁上下，佢哋又揾我去做呢個展覽，咁所以就不如將我不嬲諗嘅嘢，就將佢順便梳理，將佢擠落呢個展覽度咁樣咯。
其實你嚟彩嘅興趣係幾時開始？
我想去大學畢業後兩三年就差不多了。
尼采有沒有將你變成一個悲觀的人？
按道理應該會變成一個很樂觀的人的，但我自己悲觀而已。
因為我自己記得同阿華相處嘅時候咧，阿華係非常之就好似而家咁樣，佢係比較文靜優雅，就佢係，但係佢咧好憤怒嘅。點知佢憤怒咧？就呢家睇唔到個樣啦，但係你會喺佢嘅作品度睇到。啊，我記得嗰陣時阿董建華先生就係特首嘅時候咧，佢嗰陣時就已經畫嗰張畫，我好記得嘅，即係幫阿董建華算命，而係即係冇句好嘢嘅基本上。但係好奇怪嗰陣時嘅一個年青人點解對一個老人家咁唔體諒？但係咧就但係同時咧，我覺得佢好有實咧諗法喎，即係呢個諗法係其實如果以當時嘅大學生，譬如話好似廿一二歲啲，即係我嗰度好難諗，又唔係而家嘅一種嘅政治境況啦，係嘛？咁點解咁關心呢啲嘢？呢個一啦，第二咧點解咁憤怒？第三咧就係睇個樣根本就唔似會嬲嘅，即係唔會發嬲嘅人。所以我就覺得好似尼采呢樣嘢。你正話提到話，如果喺大學裏邊嘅時候開始接觸，我覺得就好有意思嘅一件事。但係我都想，因為翻轉頭，因為都有啲OK， 有啲舊嘅一啲作品，有啲舊嘅作品係你早期一啲嘅主要用詩人做嘅作品。
嗯。
今次嘅作品其實都唔係第一次，即係話用一啲 multimedia 嚟到去做啦。咁之前亦都有啲叫詩人嘅。關於手工的一些作品，甚至是你也曾經跟我分享過早期的詩人是你自己印的，即是手腳那麼掛。最有趣最有趣的一件事就是說，你甚至告訴我，我說為什麼印得那麼差的，他就會告訴我，我特登的。那即是那個手工藝的瑕疵，還有現在今時今日那個digital media 的準確性，其實兩樣東西呢在空間上的表達啦，這個一啦，還有在技術上的準確性的拿捏呢，其實你覺得你有些什麼看法？你會不會懷念回以前的一種，即是那種的粗糙的趣味啊，或者是那種操作方法，跟現在呢要透過 teamwork 來完成它之間呢，那個分別你覺得在哪裡？
其實咧，今次好彩咧，就有人幫我手去 set up 嘅，但係大部分時間咧，都係我自己一個人去 set up 我而家嘅 video 嘅。大部分時間都係嘅。咁所以嗰啲粗糙嘅地方就喺我 set up 嘅時候表現到出嚟咯，即係嗰種人性嘅嘢。即係可能 synchronize 嗰度可能又爭幾格，但係又俾我見到，咁我自己好苦惱，點樣去做好啲咧？咁或者係。某啲嘅電腦或者器材上，其實我又可能唔係好專業得好緊要，咁又未去到好完美嗰種效果咯。
但係你心底嗰句説話啦，我想問，其實呢啲 bugs 咧，其實係回應緊你嗰種對手藝嘅唔完整嘅一種嘅即係點講咧？未必真係有人會追求到最完整，即係好 professional。有時如果真係好順滑嘅時候，反而未必係好事嚟喎。即係藝術就唔同，唔同一啲 multimedia 嗰啲 commercial 嘅表演啊嘛，嗰啲要好準。但係呢度嘅時候，你點樣睇啲科技咧？
啲科技，我又覺得唔需要一定好完美嘅。呢個好似係一個藉口咁。咁但係我都想佢會做。有時我都冇辦法，或者係有某啲細微嘅嘢，或者唔完美嘅嘢，我係可以接受到嘅，因為我覺得完美係基本上冇可能做到嘅。只不過係嗰啲嘢硬係好似成日會俾我自己捉到，又好似揞住嘅感覺咯。
即係你哋唔想嗰啲不完美嘅瑕疵出現嘅。
某方面啦，譬如話可能喺同步度。Synchronize 嗰部可以，我覺得應該會處理，應要處理得好啲嘅。
因為我見到你嗰兩個窗咧，因為喺video可能大家睇唔到啦，但係根據佢嘅描述咧，喺個窗嗰埲牆咧，其實係不斷咧特登有啲水咧係不斷流落嚟嘅。即係簡單嚟講咧，兩個窗嗰個隔離嗰埲牆咧係濕嘅。 地下咧都係濕嘅，即係呢類咁嘅設置其實就好唔能夠控制嘅東西嚟。而呢啲唔能夠控制東西咧，分分鐘就會變成一啲感情上邊嘅一啲嘅牽引嚟嘅。啊，對於呢樣嘢同嗰個即係我見到今次漂亮嘅地方就係話嗰個準確嘅部分同埋一啲好人性化、好自然嘅部分之間嗰個交疊，嗰個交匯咯。咁你有一樣嘢我都幾有趣，因為我都同佢傾過偈啦。譬如好似呢樣嘢，可能我哋要轉個話題，就翻去你個創作方法。因為據我所知咧，就係你好多嘅材料咧，其實都唔係你自己一手創作出嚟嘅。譬如話好早期嘅絲印上面嗰啲花嘅pattern 入邊嗰啲字咧，都唔係你作出嚟噶嘛，係嘛？有啲係，有啲唔係啦。
有啲唔係啦。
咁而後期咧，你都有啲作品咧，係好多時係會用嗰啲 TV commercial 啦，甚至 YouTube 裏邊嘅一啲嘅 clips 啦，你要做噶嘛。咁至到今次咧，你都有話俾我聽，就話甚至你啲係嚟自電影啦，嚟自書籍嘅語句啦，甚至嚟自 commercials 啦、YouTube 啦呢啲咁。所以你嘅 resolution 其實都係唔準確，所以正話我同你一齊一路講嘅一條線咧，係講緊一個準確同埋唔準確，幾時收得好緊，幾時放得好鬆，呢個咁嘅節奏關係。另一個關係咧就係話，你其實唔係真係創造緊啲嘢，你其實係 edit 緊啲嘢咯，綜合緊啲嘢。咁樣講，你覺得會唔會對你唔公平？我哋點睇呢種創作方法同埋所謂叫一手創作方法之間個距離喺邊？
冇，因為我自己會覺得，譬如話，譬如話 YouTube 嘅片段，其實係有時我會自己覺得，因為而家每個人其實用電話去影相、影 video， 其實好容易，又可以影張好大量。咁但係我又覺得，其實我會有啲保留，我唔想求其咁樣就去影，求其就去拍個 video。咁因為我覺得好似好容易會做咗好多垃圾嘢出嚟嘅。咁但係其實我相對覺得，其實可能喺網上邊或者其他嘅地方，其實你會揾到一啲好適合你用，而佢哋亦都係非常好嘅一啲片段咯。咁但係我喺用嘅時候或者揀嘅時候，其實又唔係求其攞嚟用嘅，我會有特別原因或者有個參考原因先至會攞嗰啲嘢去做一個 reference 咁咯。咁所以譬如好似電影嗰啲，我哋因為咁啱佢同我所要講嘅嘢一樣，即係配合到，亦都我自己亦都好中意，咁所以先會攞嚟做處理，然後先再講我嘅故仔出嚟咯，或者我
呢個係方便啦，定係一種刻意嘅做法咧？即係用二手材料可以係刻意喎，即係話我以後我都會用二手材料，因為用二手材料可能因為係關於一啲 intertextual 嘅一啲嘅處理方法嚟嘅嘛。即係話佢唔一定，即係你話加多咗一層意義啊嘛，就係因為同其他嘅 text 有關咯。如果你以一手創造嘅時候，你就未必跟其他的 text 有關，這個是很直接的一個 intertextual， 即是這個挪用其他的物料，你有沒有想過這個？
因為我覺得其實你沒可能或者沒有所謂新的東西，你所謂你個人的東西其實都是 based on 以前的東西或者人家的東西，所以我會覺得，因為我想我自己的作品會說的東西或者指涉的東西會多一點，所以我覺得去用某啲嘅材料作為我一個元素，甚至乎然後再加埋一個紙摺嘅話，會令到嗰個作品嗰個層次會多少咯。
問下呢個其實關唔關乎咧？即係譬如早期嘅創作，其實你好多時候就好即係 focus 喺嗰個 personal touch 啊，嗰種情感嗰種嘅即係表達啊。咁但係後期其實你會有講話，其實你想即係保持一啲嘅距離，因為你唔想好太同你太你個感情太過即緊密咁樣，這個關唔關乎咧？即係想保持一段嘅距離，所以其實你都想用一啲係翻嘅 footage 啊，翻嘅 materials 啊，等你唔需要直接咁樣即係將嗰樣嘢係自己表達出嚟。
我冇諗過呢個問題，不過可能係嘅。我唔知啊，唔知。
即係其實個距離啊，其實我諗阿蘇蘭問呢個即係話你好有趣啊！如果你揾翻 footage 咧，你好容易會製造一種距離，因為你嗰啲讀者有機會知道呢個係 footage， 所以咧唔同嘅 text 將你縫接埋佢一齊嘅時候咧，佢就未必有一種統一感喺度。
嗯。
冇統一感嘅時候，咪有一種同你自身有種距離。我都有興趣就話。你對於呢種距離，即係話你自己自身同埋個作品之間嘅距離，其實係咪一種刻意嘅？同埋你覺唔覺得有距離先？可能要問先問呢個問題，有冇距離先？第二咧，如果有嘅話咧，呢種距離係咪刻意嘅？
我諗我以前嘅距離冇咁多嘅，以前會直接啲嘅。咁我諗呢幾年嘅距離會越嚟越大啲嘅，甚至呢種距離係唔係淨係同？外邊甚至不同外即其他人啦，有時甚至乎同可能自己都會有少少距離喺度嘅，即係有時會都觀察翻自己某啲嘢嘅，咁亦都會有嘅。咁呢種我人哋講開，咁我會留意，似乎呢幾年嘅情況會比較明顯少少咯。
因為如果講翻即係以前嗰啲粗口花啦，我叫佢做啊，即係用一個比較。直接的講法，即係講粗口。我諗唔到曾建華會講粗口喎。嗱，你睇下個樣，點講粗口？但係咧，佢心真係會講粗口咯。好啦，咁講粗口咁啊，有啲嘢有個載體要包住呢啲粗口。即係簡單嚟講，有埲牆啦，或者有一個載有 carrier 啦嚇，裝住嗰啲嘢。包裝嗰啲嘢，咁嗰啲當然啦。你咁樣包裝完粗口之後咧，個粗口更加粗口，因為粗口同埋花距離太遠啦。又因為呢咁嘅距離咧，造成咧嗰個 contradiction 咧更加大。
嗯。
但係咧有趣嘅地方就係睇啲花又好，睇你啲字又好，我哋永遠都係一方面唔係好容易睇啦。我哋每次都你都要嗰個觀眾俾一啲 effort， 即係俾一啲付出一啲。努力才可以看得到，譬如走近一點慢慢看，這個走近一點慢慢看，這種某程度對於觀眾來說都是一種距離來的。但是呢有趣的地方就是你生產這些影像的時候，其實呢我估在中間某程度，因為我現在不是在做 Psycho Analysis， 但是就有機會是其實就是你要透過呢啲方法嚟表達一個內容嘅時候，其實真係嗰個內容如果係好 powerful， 即係個現實如果係真係強到一個地步，你未必真係好容易會即時接受到。會唔會有呢種情況？定係我只不過係太過多疑？
點樣即時接受到？
即係話你即係譬如佢講粗口咁，你即時講唔到，咁我透過畫去講。我估你不是真的有個講粗口癖的，我只不過覺得是憤怒，即是一種對於事物的觀察的時候有一種未必是甚至未必是憤怒，即是有一種叫做有一種 critical 的 attitude。
我對不少東西都有感覺的，咁只不過通常都會唔表現出嚟嘅，或者係將佢自己壓埋一邊啊咁樣咯。咁所以就我諗係我嘅作品係我相對會宣泄到自己，講到自己壓抑咗嘅某啲感覺出嚟咯。
哇！呢個真係有興趣嘅。
點啊？
你壓抑咗啲咩？唔係對咩有感覺先？呢個第一。你點啊？對唔少嘢都有感覺。
即係憤怒嗰啲咯。
憤怒
或者其他。
邊類型嘢咧？係咪社會議題啊？定係某啲人啊？定係？
其實樣樣都有嘅喎，即係可能我睇電視睇新聞見到某啲嘢會憤怒，或者係可能喺街度搭緊地鐵見到某啲人某啲行為，我覺得好似。不太好，有的時候可能留意自己某些言行舉止，又覺得咦好像又不太好，這樣也會有的。
如果這樣說，這是很日常的，甚至如果我會不會可以這樣假設，其實就是 香港的日常環境令到你產生這些反應？即是說如果你去外國會不會有這種憤怒？即我就這樣聽而已，不知道是我自己 將一個 context 是這樣下去，
未必關事的。即可能譬如去到外國，其實可能會我會留意自己的多一點都不定，因為很多時候自己的表現出來的東西其實跟可能外國外外國的人的表現，其實我會自己再留意多一點，或者可能有少少差別，而那種差別令我有少少有時都會挺在意的。是的，
我覺得一定有，因為即係你讀緊書，都係翻返去董建華嗰張好巨型嘅版畫一樣，就係、是、始終都係好快就對政治有一個幾敏鋭嘅觸覺，同埋想講嘢咯。這個真係唔係好少，唔係好常見。即係如果喺當時嘅
嗰個年代，
嗰個年代嚇、你算係好突出地，即係做一張咁大畫，仲要係對於個政治有一個好直接的一個的表達。但有趣的就是那個表達呢，如果在藝術的範疇裡面呢，未必真的很有力的，因為你始終你的畫都是給我看的，或者給旁邊的同學看的，就是他的、那個擴散性始終有限。不過、對於政治這個議題，當然你今次講的無盡虛無，其實就好像脫了政治的東西，脫了政治東西，但其實又好像不是，因為你現在講的那個Torin Horse 嗰、那個嗰套，其實就已經係翻去一啲好幾人性嘅東西啦嚇。啲、人性嘅東西，你可能會有一種假設，就係話嗰個人性嘅一個嘅本質啦嘅一啲東西。咁嗰啲嘢就其實你對於呢啲咁本質嘅東西，佢就會衍生一啲唔同嘅現象，即係話。人性如果是這樣的時候，他就會有些現象，有些行為走出來。對這些行為，如果你用 Nietzsche 的看法，其實他會不會是一種批判呢？就是說、你覺得對於這些叫做不好的現象的時候，當然本身的那件事有詩意的，作為一個 image， 但如果作為一個事實呢，其實就很難啃的咯，就是說鞭打的馬的、很難啃的咯，那很難啃，即很難接受。同埋藝術作為一個媒材去表達的時候，其實我想中間可能是找到一個很有趣的接點，就是說藝術家就是透過藝術的方式來到去處理現實咯。你會不會同意啊？還是即是說你處理現實的方式是透過藝術的方法來到去吸收它？
不知道
OK，
我比較有興趣的，尤其是說關於它那種距離，但又有很大的很多的情感，因為我發覺其實很多時候跟你聊的時候，尤其是之前做那個即係訪問啊，即係喺個 prepare 個展覽嘅時候，就發覺啊，其實佢好多時候都有一啲即係都幾唔同嘅，即係佢一個人，但係佢有好多幾唔同嘅面向。譬如另一個面向，我會諗，譬如話佢講啊 ，Chariot Allegory， 其實係講緊嗰個戰車嗰個比喻啦。咁呢個都係好有趣，係即係其中一個比喻就係講緊就係話即係呢個其實都係其中一個作品的一個即係象徵意義啦，就係嗰三個拱門。你跟我講話中間嗰個就係一個即係個車夫啦，咁一邊咧就係白馬一個黑馬，白馬咧就代表理性，黑馬咧就代表非理性。咁咧個成個 allegory 就係講緊即係點樣可以控制，即係要得到即係幸福、快樂同埋即係一個即係人生點樣好啲咧，就其實係點樣去攞咗個平衡。但我有時都諗緊啊，其實你係咪真係攞緊個平衡咧？定還是其實你都即係 keep 住有呢一種即係兩個面向咁樣產生嘅咯？咁樣即係就頭先好似頭先講嗰種，有時好有 keep a distance， 但其實你裏邊有好多嘅 emotions， 但其實你又要 release， 但其實你又要即係克制住自己，要有個距離咁樣。我唔知係咪即係
即我覺得係幾有趣嘅呢個都。
其實我都唔知想點㗎，有陣時候都好難攞到嗰個平衡點。
你真係諗緊，你真係諗緊攞平衡㗎？其實
我其實冇諗過攞平衡嘅，只不過我唔知攞。我都不知道想怎樣，其實即對於這方面我真的不知道怎樣處理法。
其實很有趣，我看到即曾建華呢，就即如果看回好像即香港藝術家的類型來說呢，他真的是一個少數，即這件事我也想問回你們，即為什麼會選他即係咯，即係點咁多藝術家點樣揀？唔係話佢唔好啊，即係話佢點解點？即係佢好獨特嘅，因為佢一佢有一個好強嘅我覺得啦，所有藝術家都應該係某程度係有壓抑嘅，即係我自己嘅觀察啊，即係有壓抑嘅藝術家咧，其實佢啲作品有 power， 通常都係咁，所以某程度咧，我會覺得。某程度好藝術家都有某程度的心理的一些東西啊。
問題係
嘛？啊，梗係嗱，我盡量 diplomatic 啲，咁你又係要拆穿曬。咁即係呢個一啦嚇，即係有一種內在嘅需要要表達啦嚇。第二樣咧就係知識嚇，知識。曾建華好少數，我見到即係呢兩樣嘢能夠撈得咁好嘅嚇。當然嗰個外在知識咧，某程度係一個 metaphor 嚟嘅啫，即係話點樣令到嗰啲壓抑嘅東西被睇到，被轉化成為一啲 symbol， 被睇到，被理解到。而呢個被理解到咧，又可以連結一個咧更加大嘅。一個知識系統，那個知識系統可以是歷史，可以是文學，可以是哲學。那我覺得這個本身那個，即是如果以香港藝術家來計算，我覺得如果我們譬如說很 expressive 的藝術家，我們都會見過，啊，即是譬如李傑是一個很不同的，即是他其實基本上的作品在說自己，啊，即是說自己對於微末的事物，特別是很 daily 的東西的一種反應，而呢他很勇敢，同埋咧係好 honest 咁樣嚟到去講，就係得咁多啦。如果你要 drama， 就係呢啲 drama 啦。drama 就係 compress 喺一個好窄嘅空間，係咁多啦。咁但係如果係以阿華嚟講，今次咧係好相幾唔同嘅。但係如果李傑同埋阿華嚟到計，咁相大家都有啲壓抑嘅，我自己覺得嚇，先話有呢啲叫好嘅作品走出嚟。咁但係有趣咧就係話阿華今次咧就係。是將它向外投射，那個投射就變成一些知識 的東西，而這些知識的東西呢，當我們接觸的時候呢，它變成一個可以被理解的東西，當然也是心，今次就聽 Dorian 說，不是，就算有些就要講四間房用一個這麼精簡這麼到位的一個詞彙來描述，其實都已經是非常之 難能可貴的一件事。所以今次我覺得其實好像是一個理性和一個感性之間的交匯，怎樣拿到個平衡。感性的部分就是你對於事物的一個看法啦，中間可能有些 很悲觀的一些情緒啦，其實很情緒，我覺得即係成件事雖然話看上嚟好像很按部就班，同埋每一間房都有一個很靚的一個連接，同埋很 well planned。但是同時這個 well-planned 的東西是其實入了去一個幾邏輯和幾講道理的一個系統，但是我覺得個 core 呢其實都是那個即是個人對於生命的看法。
No, I, you know, I was just thinking that Kurt, your characterization or explanation of Hua's work is so beautifully put that I wish you were there during the discussion for the selection of artists. Then we would have been even more convincing. But I think, you know, what we should, you perhaps reveal and share is that the, in a sense, criteria for selection for not just Hong Kong, but you know, these kinds of exhibitions in which you are supposed to represent, right? Mm. Criteria for selection in these cases are in many ways very simple. That you want an artist who has a confident practice, a mature practice, who can use this kind of a platform, which is high visibility and quite tricky place to work in. Even if you are lucky enough to have a permanent pavilion in the Giardini, it's still not easy to work in Venice. Mm-hmm. You know, and I've been explaining to people that imagine trying to put together, often, you know, these days, if you do contemporary art, you know, it's very involved, whether technically or materially. But imagine trying to do that in a medieval city. I mean, because that's what Venice is. It doesn't have all the modern conveniences. So you need an artist who can, who has the strength as well as the flexibility. And, you know, I guess Stella certainly knew Duncan Wong much better than I did, but I'm not sure if you actually had a chance to work with him professionally. I don't think so, right?
I think in 2006, because, you know, we have a group exhibitions, he's also one of the artists. Oh,
so I guess maybe that's why Stella was so calm about it, but, you know, I didn't, I had never had a chance to work with him. So, you know, it's a bit of a leap of faith, but then, you know, it's not just leap. You know, you see what the artist has done previously, the different kinds of contexts and institutions he has worked in and what he was able to pull off. And based on that, you have confidence to select the artist. And again, you know, this might sound a bit vulgar, but the reality of what this is beyond beyond the artist being strong enough to represent and carry on that responsibility. But you can carry on the responsibility by not thinking about that as a responsibility, which I think is what exactly Hua did. So he just focused on his work, but you still have to be very strong to be able to do this job. But beyond that, I think it kind of becomes the curator's job as the selector to think about what it means to be in Venice again with an exhibition with 150 artists plus another 150 exhibitions. I mean, like, this is trying to kind of stand out in, to put it rather crassly, but this is the reality. And then you want an artist who can deliver an impact in this kind of context so that you don't get lost in the crowd. So, you know, I mean, these are the kinds of considerations on top of our confidence in somebody's aesthetic and artistic capacity that we as curators have to bring to this kind of context.
That's a very interesting point. I think when you chose Zheng Qinhua, it seems that you have a crystal ball in your hand, at least, to project what kind mm-hmm. of each effect he could produce in the venue. And I can see one of the reasons, maybe your team is just, you might have a lot of confidence on your team that even, well, if the when the worst come to the worst, if Zheng Qinhua cannot perform well, then your team can still, you know, create some spectacle by employing a lot of expertise to help him to produce at least some stunning images or effect in the show. Wow. Is that? Well, no, maybe this is maybe.
I don't even want to think about that. I mean, I think the curators and the supporting team can only be so much of a crutch, you know. I mean, yeah, we are facilitator, especially in this kind of an exhibition. But I think one has to realize. I mean, really appreciative of the acknowledgement that you give us for the work that we did. We did work very hard, but. You know, if the artist doesn't, I'm not just talking about him, but just the general artist does not deliver and cannot stand up to the pressure, then there's only so much that we can do. We cannot make the work for the artist.
Yes, of course.
Yeah, so, you know, I mean, I think we were a support system, we were crutch, we were a buttress or whatever you call it. But, you know, if the main building falls apart, there's so much we can do. You know, I mean,
that's true.
Maybe that's not a good metaphor. But anyway, but you know what I mean, you know.
Yeah, because nowadays I'm quite interested in the exhibition strategy sometimes. I mean, sometimes when you see it in an exhibit, it's not the contents that the exhibit itself can carry, but the presentation method really help to deliver some sort of, I mean, to strengthen at least the power of the work itself.
So I think just as he mentioned, I mean, normally he will finish the exhibition like in story works by himself, but normally it's quite manually, you know, like, you know, doing the edge blending. He said normally he just do it, you know, using, you know, just you from his eyes. But this time, you know, we try to have, you know, professionals like, you know, AV technicians and consultants. They're really good in doing this. They have a software to do this. And then, so that's the reason why we try to give him more time so he can, you know, he can just stay there and then, you know, just supervise the whole thing. He doesn't really need to spend too much time, you know, worrying about this part, but he can focus more on other details of the shows. I think this is also a good way of, you know, supporting the artist.
So I think it's time maybe we can open the floor. Any questions?
中文或者英文都 OK 的。
Okay. John has a question. John?
Hi. Chan Yeo-kung. It's quite an interesting discussion from my point of view, because generally I avoid these sort of discussions because people don't ask many hard questions of an artist. I've been to many artists, so-called artist discussions, particularly with Chinese artists, and everyone's all over them being polite and saying how wonderful they are, and you know, frankly, it's very boring.
Am I too rude?
You are wonderfully rude, and it's the sort of discussion that people don't usually have in public. But in fact, I found it quite interesting because, of course, most people here don't know Chan Kin-hwa like you and I do. And yes, he is a very quiet person, and yes, he's probably angry like all of us, but probably no more so. And so I found it a little bit unfair that he was put in the spotlight a little bit, because he is actually a remarkably sensitive person. I don't know if you quite actually said that. And I think in some ways you got away with it because he bears his soul more than other artists who in some ways do personal work, but you still don't know the hell of what they're talking about. And it's interesting you compared him to Lei Gid, whose work is all about himself. But in fact, Chan Kin-hwa is very interesting because if you look at the images just behind you, of course, that's a flower pattern based on a well-known British designer, full of swear words, profane language. And in fact, it's the sort of language which we all use, not just Chan Kin-hwa, even though you may not say it. What I actually want to really say is that's all, that it was quite refreshing. And I'm not particularly interested in the technical side or even the selection criteria, although that's interesting, Dorian. I think that is also quite interesting. I think we've got a very worthy worthy representative this year. And if I can go back, because Chan Yeo-kung himself was a representative, and I think his experience was a hell of a lot different, because I have to say this quite vocally, when the Arts Development Council, which is a funding body, they should never try and organize something themselves because they don't have that expertise. So unfortunately, you were with that group of artists for many years who, you know, you did your thing. And so we also have to acknowledge people like Chung Kin-wha who came earlier and allowed a very wonderful artist like, Chun Yo-kung who came earlier, who allowed an artist like Chung Kin-wha to get the support that each artist does deserve. Yeah. So it's really a comment, not really anything else.
Thank you. Oh, there is one.
想問下曾經話先生咧，咁一本嘢話曾經係虔誠嘅基督徒啦，咁後屘就即係唔知係離開咗定還是係即係尋求緊信仰嗰樣嘢，咁想問其實依刻咧個呢啲作品同個基督教信仰或者尼采呢啲即係當中有啲咩關係，或者入面仲有冇啲咩掙扎個人想？
我以前係基督徒嚟嘅，咁後屘就冇信啦。咁但係我諗信基督教嗰段時間，其實對我影響好深遠嘅。咁長情我唔多講啦。咁但係即係所以而家做唔少嘅作品，其實好多時候都會牽涉到基督教嘅。咁 基督教之後，即係尼采又係一個影響我好緊要嘅一個思想家啦。咁所以兩方面其實對我影響都好深遠嘅，尤其是即係當而家嘅作品好大部分都係牽涉到關於即係人或者關於人性呢樣嘢嘅時候，咁即係作為一個宗教，再加上即係哲學，好多時候就係講人同人性嘅嘢有關，咁所以就
對我嚟講，呢兩樣都係一個好主要我做作品時候嘅參考資料咯。我想問曾建華先生啦，頭先聽咗咁多。旁敲側擊咁樣去問呢個大環境入邊，你嘅 position 啦，你答問題方式好多都係環繞翻你自己。咁好啦，如果我哋頭先有聽完，你行翻出嚟，你睇到可能其他 contemporary Chinese artist 或者呢一個用 presentation 或者用一個 team 去幫助一件事嘅完成，你自己又點樣走翻出嚟去 comment 呢個 scenario？ 有咩或者你聽完咁多，你其實有咩你好想反駁嘅嘢？我佢哋講緊形容緊某啲嘅事啦，咁但係呢樣嘢同我又好似或者同今次嘅展覽其實冇乜特別大關聯，所以我冇乜特別嘅 comment 咯。或者你對於今日Hong Kong art scene 你有乜嘢你個人嘅觀察，或者係你嘅一個 critical position？
邊方面啊？我有冇話特別邊方面你想睇到問到我嘅意見？例如頭先聽完。
佢講嘅嘢，你有乜嘢你自己諗緊？我好 curious 想知道俾一個你反駁嘅機會，或者我其實唔中意反駁嘅，因為我比較少同人爭論或者同人傾嘅。咁通常人哋講完嘅嘢，通常我會聽咗咁我。
自己翻去諗究竟佢講嘅嘢啱唔啱咁，譬如頭先阿 John 講緊我嘅作品嘅時候，其實我即係當然佢我知道佢理解我嘅作品都好多，咁所以我亦都好尊重佢嘅意見，咁所以我冇乜特別。
又例如佢講嘅係當年係藝發局去做一件事，相比今日 M Plus 去做一件事，你覺得 M Plus 對於去栽培你或者其他新世代嘅藝術家，或者點樣去 nurture 香港一個 art 嘅 ecosystem， 你有冇一個睇法或者一個 standpoint？
我只能純即係純粹基於我今次做展覽嘅經驗啦，同埋睇翻之前李傑做嗰個展覽嘅睇到出嚟效果咯，我覺得佢哋係喺我呢個 project 入邊，即係或者我接觸到嘅一啲佢哋嘅同事，佢哋都係好用心去做，去幫我完成我想要做嘅作品咯。咁同埋佢哋亦都有時可能會比我更加專業地，令到我有少少唔係幾好意思咁咯。咁但係即係我即係 feel 到佢哋喺幫我去完成呢個作品，或者係去 carry out 呢次展覽嘅時候，係佢哋會係幫咗好多，同埋令到我相對解決咗好多問題，都個效果比我想象中會好嘅。即當然當年陳生的情況我就不是太清楚，因為我只是好像你們一樣，就是 在香港看一些資料，看一些網上的相片，樣其實背後的情況是怎樣，其實我就不是很清楚的。
老實說，坊間很多關於一些爭論，關於究竟 ADC 做好一點，就是開放一個平台給一些 local curator 來到去參與呢個威尼斯，即係咁重要嘅展覽，定係留翻俾 M Plus 去做好啲咧？咁我諗喺過往兩屆，我所見到無論喺策略啦、人物啦，因為做一個展覽，正如好似正話 Stella， 當然好多 technical 嘅嘢，譬如話好似點樣去處理嗰個場地啊等等。佢都即係 M Plus 都會有一個幾完整嘅同埋幾 professional 嘅一個 team 咧嚟處理。咁我可以話俾大家聽咧，就我參加嗰屆咧，其實嗰個場地應該大過而家曾建華嗰個場地。講啲係我哋兩個人分，但可以話俾你聽，所有嘢都係我哋自己做，掃地啦、起嘢啦。嗰邊嘅人咧會話我哋聽咩唔做得，就正如好似正話 Stella 都有提到嘅話，基本上。除了地下之外，除了地之外，什麼都不行了、所以你要 realize 你的 project 呢，其實一方面時間很短，我們應該有不知三四個月左右， 就要好像第二 proposal 可以只有兩個月，就是說你由有個人找你做，直到你 design 好說我要做什麼，其實的時間大概一個月左右。其實你去我們決定了被選了之後呢，再去到 site 再看到發生什麼事呢，根本就沒有空間呢回去再 revise 我的 proposal， 因為會不讓你改，就是說我去到看到說咦不對路，不是這樣的，那我再回來想改呢沒得改，因為他會告訴你哦，上面又不行，想即基本上除了地下之外你什麼都不行。這個是一個 team 的問題，因為藝發局係俾咗筆錢咧，個 curator 啦，個 curator 咧就負責派錢嘅啫。咁啊，當然佢只可以有自己嘅 team 啦。但係當然，如果同 M Plus 俾一個咁 established 嘅 team 咧，喺個technical support 咧 ，M Plus 一定會有多啲 resources。即使唔係講錢，係講人脈咧，都可能會大啲。第二咧就係、是、我注意到一樣嘢，就係嗰、那個點樣 promote 香港呢個 pavilion 咧。其實是需要很大的心力，以及有很多心思放下去。即譬如好像今次呢，我有聽到一些我太太呢有去威尼斯，她說香港今次的team很厲害的，就是說將曾建華的名字放在那個，即怎樣 present 這個項目，很多人都說什麼館什麼主題這樣而已。但是今次呢，就好像曾建華的名字是出現了在個主題之前，咁即係曾建華咧，喺當你揭嗰啲目錄嘅時候，你會見到成日見到曾建華咯。其他啲咧就會見到乜乜館，然後啲咩主題，佢都唔知咩事嘅。基本上邊個 artist 三展你都唔知嘅。基本上，咁呢啲就係咁細節、咁細節嘅嘢咧。如果你唔係 professional curator， 你都對威尼斯雙年展冇認識， 唔知道人哋點樣有個咩部署咧，你其實真係唔知道你打啲乜嘅，即係話你點樣嚟到去使到香港館同埋香港 artist 嘅作品點樣被睇到喺 among 咁多資源充沛嘅國家裏邊。所以我見到一啲好細節嘅嘢，譬如好似呢啲嘅知識咧，其實未必係真係你揾一個 local curator 可以做得到。但係嗱，我要強調一樣嘢，未必我未必會贊成以後咁多屆都會俾 M Plus 做。因為始終 local curator 需要被培養，但個合作方式咧，其實有好多空間咧，其實可以再做，譬如一個 local curator 夾 M Plus， 甚至咧當local curator 已經係成長到一個地步嘅時候，可以自立門户嘅地步，我覺得 M Plus 可能要將呢、這個resources 或者係呢個工作拎翻出嚟都唔頂，因為我覺得所有嘢發展嘅東西咧，好難話啱定係錯，而咧我覺得。如果你擺翻喺個階段嘅時候咧，你就會睇到咧喺一個階段嘅時候，喺而家嘅階段需要一啲有經驗嘅人去領頭嚟到示範俾佢睇究竟點樣做咯。
Thank you. I've got two questions. One very quick one and one a little longer maybe, but not too long. The first one is, I couldn't help noticing that the first piece in your video installation, strike through, is 4 minutes, 32 seconds long. Is that absolutely accidental that it's 1 second shorter than Cage's piece? Or is there part absolutely no connection? Is that completely accidental, which is fine. You know, if it is accidental, that's fine.
Well, I never said whether I want to have like 4 minutes 30 seconds or 4 minutes 32 or something like that. I just watch the videos and make it and feel whether it should be faster, maybe a little longer. And when that's the point, then I think I should stop it. So when it stops and I count it, okay, that is
okay.
4 minutes.
That's great. Yeah. That's absolutely fine. My second question is maybe more serious. There's been a lot of talk about the kind of connections in your piece with Nietzsche, Plato, Bellatar's film, the Bible, religion more generally. What I'm interested in is whether you could comment maybe more about the kind of aesthetic or stylistic links that you may have developed for this piece in Venice. In terms of, you know, are there any particular sources that you have been thinking about, any other artists, any other kind of connections in terms of, I don't know, the use of the monochrome, the movement for the text, the connection of the space. You've mentioned light at the beginning, the choice of lighting. Where would you situate your aesthetic in this piece in terms of any kind of connections other than the thematic connections that have been talked about?
I think, I used to like Bill Viola's videos. So that is one of the artists that I like. I mean, his video is very simple, very minimal, but at the same time, it's very powerful. So I think his works has some kind of influence on the way I choose the element and just use some very simple, the minimum amount of things to tell, the maximum thing that you can tell. And the other, artists or directors I like is Bellatar. He's actually one of my favorite directors. And so the way he used the long, short, so that is something that I particularly like, and his use of black and white film, and also that is something that I like very much as well. So I guess he has some kind of influence on me, though I'm not particularly trying to imitate his work.
Hi.
So
Is that working?
It's brilliant video, and it's really like your artwork, and something refreshing to see in amongst all those local artists, and I was just wondering, because I've seen some image from your previous work from the artists, and they're all quite subtle and just quite nice, and by comparison to the one in Venice, right? They kind of provide like a spatial journey, if you put it that way, or a lot more grounded to the site, more site-specific. That's how I see it, right? And when I just wonder, when so change happened, you know, from those prints, beautiful print, printed on the wall, they kind of like sculpture to me, but a touch of insulation, a little bit of spatiality, which and those into our work, and the one in Venice is because you'd mentioned the journey of life and journey, how you see life, right? And that when, I just wonder when those changes happen, is that...
You mean when I change my
focus?
So or focus direction? Or
style, direction, or whatever. When those happen? You didn't see it yet.
I guess it's something happens, not in a very short period of time, but roughly around 2008 and 2009. And so I just like Professor Chen mentioned before, that my previous work in a long time ago, they are actually quite directly linked with the social,
political
issues. But I guess that around after that some years, then I, especially during 2008 and 2009, so there was a time that I start to think about what I've done before and try to review all the things relate to my works and myself and societies, and I realized that it's that lots of problems appear in societies and in the world, but I guess the fundamental issue, the fundamental problem is actually related to the humans, and that is the problem of human nature. So it's also about relate to my personal so-called crisis at that time. So I guess during that period of time, then I start to shift it a little bit to focus more about human and human nature. So which is why I start to make the video projections at that time. And the first series is actually the work that I done particularly during that period of time. So after that, then I guess I'll just talk more about the human natures and then religions and more about the philosophy, which is actually something about humans as well.
Can I actually probe that a little bit more specifically? So clearly there is pretty radical change. Continuity, but still a pretty radical change. And you know, the most obvious way of saying that is that you are using static image and that you started using moving image. Did you feel that this difference in medium and technique is more effective in conveying the sort of the point of crisis and then the kinds of things that you were interested in at the time? In other words, for the lack of better term, the content and the medium, are they related?
I think before I start making this kind of video, I had a questions in my mind that I feel like my previous work, they are actually like something frozen in the air. So they are literally right there, they're stuck in this place, and I just feel doesn't it it has certain kind of problem, if I would like to mention it. So after that, then I start to make some, to add more sound, to even use light projections, but I still feel that there's certain kind of problems in it. And so during that period of time, during that year, then I feel like that there's some kind of thing that I should make the text move and to make it more like a whole environment and space that you can actually feel the certain kind of atmosphere there. And that is something that I don't know why, but I feel like it depicts the way I feel in a more accurate way or in a more precious way. And so when I look at the videos I've made in the past few years, I still feel there's somehow I still feel that kind of heaviness and the dense feeling that I had during that period of time. Yeah. So I maybe they work together quite well, I guess.
I think maybe we have time for one more question, one last question, if anybody has.
At times during the, just to continue that on a little bit, at times during the video in Venice, the work becomes basically illegible. Is there, because all of the words blend together and coalesce, is there a particular reason for making your statements less clear?
I think for the first half of the video is, how to say it? The first half of the video is actually something that you can read the text, and the text is actually move a little bit slow, that you can actually pick up all the works and all the contents. So I guess after a certain period of time, especially after, well, during the middle part of the videos, then I guess, the video is focused more about building up the emotion, building up the atmosphere. So I think it's fine or it's reasonable that you can't read all the text during that period, during that part of the video. So, which is why I guess most of the texts I wrote for the videos, they actually appear in the first, they already appeared in the first half of the videos. So you can already know the contents of the videos and what I'm trying to say during, just because of that part. And that's it, yeah.
I guess if I may add sort of my own take on it, I guess, and of course I had seen a lot of his earlier works, many of the Seven Seals series, but I was really struck by standing in, especially the fourth video where with the three side projection only of text. I had this kind of moment, this was just before the opening, so installation was almost finished, then you see the words as he was just describing, being sucked into the middle black hole in legible way. So your brain starts working in a way that you're trying to make sense between these fragmentary words and phrases, right? And then quickly they start overtaking the space and it becomes illegible. And so the kind of realization that I had is that, you know, maybe I have a psychological problem, but I often have this experience sort of at the end of the day, you know, you're lying in bed just before you're drifting into the unconscious, that you almost kind of see your thoughts and words floating and clashing, and it becomes this, creates a void into which you fall asleep, right? Because as I think it's maybe Jacques Lacan who said that the consciousness is a structure like language. But like that's what it means to be a social being, right? Like when we learn to be a social being that communicates through language that is agreed upon, then your consciousness becomes structured as a language. But when you're on the edge between consciousness and the unconscious, then the words begin are still there because that's how your consciousness is structured. But there are certain moments that you see that broken down, you know? And sort of like I kind of had that experience almost as if that liminal moment of your mind is being projected outwards, you know? So it was quite, for me, a profound but kind of frightening experience as well. Because you know, it's almost like if somebody's putting a giant projector inside your brain and you see it being projected. So you see the workings and the breakdown of your mind. So I just wanted, I don't know if I mentioned that to you, but you know, I just kind of wanted to share sort of the kind of sublime and terrorizing moment that I experienced by standing in that space. So, thank you. So, are
we? Thank you all for coming, and thank you to all of our speakers. I'd like to draw your attention to the next talk in this series, which will be on June 17th. We've got Professor Toguo Cheng from Chinese University, who will speak with us on the subject of film and philosophy. So please, I'd like to thank our speakers this evening for a really interesting and very in-depth discussion of the Venice Biennial and the exhibition, and in particular to Zheng Jinhua for sharing so generously of your thoughts and ideas. So thank you all for coming.